So let's start by considering this problem where you had an equivalence relation defined on S being the set of all real numbers. That's different than the equivalence relation problem that we had at the end of class on Friday. The equivalence relation itself is a little different as well. We're defining A to be equivalent to B if and only if. I can abbreviate if and only if with IFF, or an arrow pointing both ways, double implication. If and only if, how is it described in the book? If A minus B is an integer. The goal is to prove that this is an equivalence relation and also describe the equivalence classes, and perhaps the description of the equivalence classes you found more difficult than the proof itself, but let's see what the proof is like. Once again, you should write proofs in sentences. I will try to be a little bit picky about that. Maybe you might feel too picky, but it's something we want to work on. The proof I did last Friday, I just gave you the outline. So we should start by saying, first, let's prove the reflexive property. I don't mind if you give some headings like we did last week. Let A be an element of the real numbers. That's really something you should start off with. I'm imagining perhaps some of you didn't. Start off by saying, referring to the set that is in question, let A be an element of A. The real numbers, we've got to show that A is equivalent to itself. Well, we know A minus A is zero, and we know zero is an integer. You don't have to prove zero is an integer. You know that. Therefore, A is equivalent to itself. I'm imagining most of you got the key reason that A minus A is zero is an integer. But again, ideally, you are trying to write sentences, so you should say something, let A be a real number to begin with. Maybe I can be a little bit more forgiving on this one since I did an outline last Friday and didn't quite do that kind of thing. But that's something to work on, okay? I'll be maybe a little bit more picky with the function ones. That's the reflexive property. You could then say something like, therefore, the reflexive property is satisfied. That's a little bit of overkill. I wouldn't necessarily be looking for that. The next one is the symmetric property. You should really start off by saying, let A and B be elements of R, the real numbers, and suppose A is equivalent to B. That's an assumption that you're making. Based on that assumption, you want to show B is equivalent to A. Since you're assuming A is equivalent to B, that means A minus B is an integer. Therefore, A minus B is an integer. Say A minus B equals K, where K is an integer. This step is not really necessary, but maybe for extra clarity, it's worth writing down that way. And maybe some of you did this. In fact, I know at least one of you did this kind of thing. Say A minus B is K, where K is some integer. Then we want to show B minus A is an integer because we're trying to show B is equivalent to A. Can I just say that? B minus A, which is negative K, is an integer? Do I need to give a reason? This is always kind of a game. Like, do I need to give a reason for this kind of thing? Maybe you want to go a little bit of overkill here at the beginning. If you didn't give a reason for this, I wouldn't mark it wrong. But just for the sake of going the extra mile, you could say, since Z is closed, undertaking additive inverses, if you want to be real official about it. I'm imagining probably nobody did that. But we're trying to go the extra mile here. K is an integer, an arbitrary integer. Its opposite, its negative, its additive inverse is also an integer. That's a property that the integers have. The natural numbers, by the way, don't have that property. What are the natural numbers? They're the positive integers, not including the negative integers, not including zero. Well, actually, some people include zero. But, you know, four is in the natural numbers, but negative four is not. The natural numbers are different than the integers. And then for the transitive property, you should really start by saying let A, B, and C all be real numbers. And suppose, again, you're making assumptions here, A is equivalent to B and B is equivalent to C. What does that mean? Go back again to the definition of the equivalence relation. Therefore, A minus B and B minus C are integers. Do I need to say this equals K and this equals M or something? You could. You don't really have to. Maybe for clarity, I'll do it. I don't mind comments like this, i.e., that's a Latin abbreviation for, in other words, there exists a K and an M in the integers, such that A minus B equals K and B minus C equals M. I get, this is a bit of overkill. But let's go ahead and finish it anyway. What are we trying to show? We're trying to show A is equivalent to C, that A minus C is an integer. What's the key thing to do here? Add them together. Magically, the B's cancel. Is it magic? It only feels like magic. It's kind of almost set up to work. You want to give an extra reason. Since Z is closed under addition, K plus M, which is A minus B plus B minus C. I'm using parentheses for the associative property. Oh man, for extra emphasis, I could even do this kind of thing. That's using the associative property. And then replace negative B plus B with zero. Simplify, get A minus C. In other words, I probably should have written this the other way around. K plus M is an integer under closure. That's where the closure comes into play. In saying that, and that equals A minus C, therefore A minus C is an integer. Okay, yeah, that's a bit of overkill. But we're trying to be kind of extra careful here at the beginning. What are the equivalence classes? That may have been harder for you. We are down here, praise the Lord. With the equivalence relation we had last Friday, on the integers, not the real, this is on the real numbers. The underlying set here is the real numbers. Two real numbers are equivalent if their difference is an integer. The equivalence relation last week, just write it over here, last Friday, S was equal to Z, and A was equivalent to B if and only if 2 divided to A minus B, if A minus B was even. And the equivalence classes, there were only two of them. All the even numbers is the equivalence class containing 0, and all the odd numbers is the equivalence class containing 1. But here, there's really infinitely many equivalence classes because the underlying set is the real numbers. Yes, well, the equivalence class containing 0 here for this example with this equivalence relation is all real numbers whose difference with 0 is an integer. That'll be all the integers, actually. Both even and odd numbers, right? Doesn't that make sense? The integers are all the numbers whose difference with 0 is an integer. This equals Z. But the equivalence class containing 1, for example, in this case is actually the same thing. The integers that's also z, but the equivalence class containing, for example, pi is very different. All real numbers whose difference with pi is an integer. No overlap with this set. There's going to be no integers in this equivalence class containing pi. What numbers will be in it? Well, pi minus 3, pi minus 2, pi minus 1, pi itself, right? Pi minus pi is 0 is an integer. Pi plus 1, pi plus 2, pi plus 3, etc. None of those is an integer, and none of them is even a rational number. They're all irrational numbers. And you can keep going with this kind of thing. What's the equivalence class containing 1.278? It would be all real numbers whose difference with 1.278 is an integer. Easier to think about with positive numbers. Save some space here. 0.278 would be one of them. 1.278 would be another. 2.278. 3.278, etc. On forever and ever. There would be negative numbers in there, but it's still a little trickier. And I do it in my head. Negative 722? Is that right? 722. Negative 1.722. Negative 2.722, etc. Okay. Make my curly brace over here. That's yet another equivalence class. And you could keep going. There are infinitely many possible equivalence classes. It's a very different kind of thing that happened. In this example, there were only two equivalence classes. In this one, there are infinitely many. You could describe the equivalence class of any real number A as being the set of all numbers of the form A plus K, where K is an integer. That's one way you could describe it. You also could describe it in terms of decimal parts. You could say, you know, whatever A's decimal is, I want to consider all integers with the same decimal part, at least when A is positive, and when A is negative, you have to do some subtraction. So it's a little bit tricky to try to describe. This is probably the simplest way to describe it. Equivalence relations are pretty important in this class, mostly for modular arithmetic at the beginning, but we're also going to be doing using equivalence classes in more advanced topics later. They play a fundamental role.